How's everybody doing? We're getting ready to get started. I'm Hugh. I'm with Worxaudio, and now I'm the Managing Director of the Loudspeaker Division for PreSonus, and really excited to be there. And just to say a little bit about the, where I come from, I started a company called Roadworks and Woodworks in 1979, and we were a production company. Started doing small productions and sort of built our own product for us. So the goal was is not to sell it, build the best product we can. Price really didn't matter. If we had a great product, people would want to rent it. So basically through the 80s, we developed our own product, did a bunch of production. And in the mid 80s, we were fortunate, picked up Waylon Jennings as an account. And at that time, I'd built a brand new TAD PA. So TAD's a loudspeaker that's made by Pioneer, one of the higher end loudspeakers that are out there. And that went on for about 5 years, and as we got to the 90s, we signed a contract with TAD, and we were the OEM manufacturer for TAD. So we separated Woodworks. We started then having manufacturing, and we worked with TAD, and then we ended up working with Selenium and several other companies. So basically, as a production company through the 90s, we did halftime for Super Bowl for about 3 years, 94, 95, 96. We did a bunch of things at the Olympics, and so it was a lot of production. And I tell people that as we got to the 2000s, I probably had a midlife crisis, and I decided to get out of the production side. And I actually got rid of the production. I changed the name to Worxaudio, so I tried to keep Works in there. And at that point in time, line arrays had become very fashionable. So we started looking at the line arrays that were out in the field in the early 2000s, and we started to develop something, and I kind of arrogantly thought that I would knock that out in 6 or 8 months, and it took us about 2.5 years to figure that out. So, but we felt like we built a really good product at that time. So just to hit on a little bit of the technical, we have a couple of different line arrays. We have an X series, which is this, and a V series, that is the smaller one over here. And we have multiple other models that are part of those, but that's what we're showing today. A little bit about our flat waveformer, what we call it, to keep our sound tight in the vertical. We actually put a phase plug in the center of our flat waveformer, and then we have vanes that go around the perimeter, and it keeps equal path lengths through the face of that. Our vanes are actually about 0.4 of an inch apart, so it controls the high frequency up to about 18K. One of the other things, once we developed the flat waveformer, that was difficult is how do you blend mid-range into that? So you see a lot of companies that are taking, for instance, 2 8-inch drivers, and they're putting them side by side, and that's either 8.5 or 8.25 inches apart. And what happens is when you're right in front of it, they show up at the same time. But when you're off axis, they sort of show up at a different time. So one thing that you can do that a lot of people are doing, you just direct radiate one of the drivers, take it up to the crossover point, and you let the other driver become an extended base. The problem with that we saw, especially in fixed installations, is that you end up with an asymmetrical pattern. So you end up from 500 to 2K, you end up with this pattern that has a lot of mid-range on one side of the pattern, and on the other side it has a lot of high frequency. What we ended up doing is we take the two drivers, we horn load those, and we take a circular pattern and we move it to a flat pattern. So in this, if you can see it, the lighting's a little dull in here, but you have a flat waveformer here, and then you have a slot and a slot, and they do cross at each other. So the two drivers are mounted this way, compression drivers mounted right in the center. We physically align those the best that we can to make that phase coherent, and they show up in at the crossover point, trying to make a nice phase response and have to do minimal delay to make that as good as it can be. This actually takes this now, and instead of being 8 or so inches apart, you end up to where it's going beyond 2K and we don't have any comb filter limits there. So we can cross these boxes over up to like 1.6K. It does a couple of things. It makes a symmetrical pattern. And it ends up to where you have about 4 to 5 more dB in level because you're coupling two components together. So what we're going to do today is just really talk a little bit and then listen. you know, so I know you guys don't want to listen to me a lot. So I'm going to start with our V5s that are over here. This is two 5-inch speakers and a 1-inch exit compression driver. It has a 1.75 voice coil. So it's the same compression driver that's in this box. And the two 5s that are in here and our 8s, our free or resonant on those, is down to 65 hertz. So that does control. We cross that, I mean, we port that down to about 65. We start to roll it off at 60. So it does part make that a nice blend of low frequency. The longer you can make this array, you can really start to throw some of that out into the room. It does have to get pretty good size, but it does help. So we'll start and listen to our what is our V5. Everything you're listening today, it does have the two subs blended in with that, and we'll just play a couple of cuts, and then we'll go to the X2s. So we're going to go back to the V5. This particular V5 has an amplifier in it. So the amplifier into 4 ohms can put out 350 by 350 watts. We have two 8-inch, 5-inch speakers, and we parallel those, takes it down to 4 ohms. Our compression driver is an 8 ohm, so it ends up seeing about half that in power when it's powered. We also make this passive, so we take the two drivers and series those and leave the compression driver at 8 ohms, and it becomes a 16 ohm speaker cabinet. So basically, you can end up putting about 4 of those on the side of an amplifier. Actually, I was wrong there. We use a 16 ohm compression driver when we do use that device. So, the other side is this is a full 10 degree line array. You can focus this in 1 degree increments, so it does allow you to make a nice long line array, control that mid bass on out into the room, and if you can flatten it out and do it right, you can get to the back of the room. We've done a lot of rooms where we're only maybe 6 to 7, 8 dB down to where at a 80 to 100 foot back compared to the front, that's doing really, really well. If you take a conventional speaker cabinet and try to do that, you would be 24 to 30 dB down. So the other thing that we have done, and we're the only company right now that's done an install, we've actually done 3 installs with AFMG's FurMaker. So we have 3 churches basically that have used FurMaker with our system. Tony over here is one of our dealers that's helping us. He did our first one. And basically we were able to get that within 2 dB. And be able to steer sound off the ceiling. So sometimes in churches, it's not perfect, but you know, you have to be right up against the ceiling. And to be able to steer that off of that, get it into the room, you can still hear some of those reverb trails, and it makes the sound sound like it's definitely more in your face. The next cuts that we're going to listen to have a little bit more. The first one has some cello in it, so you can actually hear the bow there. And then there's a couple of female tracks that have reverb trails. So we work really, really hard to make a phase alignment at the crossover point. And the way that I design things, we start with a compression driver, we build a horn, and then I take and come up with a mid-range or a bass device that has the same same phase response as the compression driver. So when you are aligning those, they're at least more in the ballpark. So take a listen, see what you think. Hear a little from the other rooms. We're going to go back and play the same cuts with the X2. This particular box today is self-powered. This has our PXD amplifier in it. It's an 800 watt by 800 watt. We also have connectability there, so it's Cat5, and it allows you to wire into it, and you end up having 10 bands of parametric. You have compressor limiter and 800 milliseconds of delay.
Wow, we cleared her really quick.
So we'll take a listen to this, and so we're just going to play one more thing. We're going to play it through the V5s. This next set of stuff has a little bit deeper bass, so we'll push that up a little bit. I'm going to talk briefly about all of our speaker cabinets. They're made here in the U.S. We have aluminum. We use 6061T. The rigging that's in here has a 10-to-1 rating. We can fly up to 24 boxes deep of those with a 10-to-1 rating. All of the cabinets are made out of Baltic birch. They go from a 15 millimeter, depending on, or an 18 millimeter, or a 24 millimeter, depending on what boxes we want to build. This sub, I'm going to talk a brief amount about, because the next cuts have a little bit more sub base. This is 24 millimeter, which is 1 inch. We have two layers of that as a baffle board. We actually recess the speaker into that baffle board to help with it blending into the box and keeping that dampening really down. We also build panels internally with a CNC router, route them into the side. It breaks up standing bones inside the box. So there's a lot of racket going on inside the box. And we use some custom insulation to really dampen the inside. I think when you're using a sub and you're really trying to go deep, you need a lot of power and you need a really good speaker. So the amplifier that we have here is our PXD series. The power supply on it is a 2,500 watt power supply. The amp puts out 2,500 watts RMS. It will swing peaks of 12,000 watts and it puts out almost a little over 200 volts. So it's a really beefy amp. It really controls that speaker a lot. So some amps, you can see it hit and they wobble a little bit. This really grabs a hold of this. This speaker is custom for us. It has a four and a half inch voice coil. So it puts out it'll take about 30% more power than a 4 inch voice coil. The X max on this speaker is 64 millimeters, so it's almost 3 inches peak to peak. Free air on it is 25. We tune the box to 25 hertz. I do a slight EQ at the port frequency. The port frequency is where you have equal pressure outside and inside on that cone, so you can manipulate that a little bit, and then we roll off pretty fast at 20. So when you're doing special effects, we sell a lot to churches. I'd say 90% of the churches we do are using this sub. It's a bit expensive, but what the pastors are saying is this is crossed over at 70 hertz on the top side, and to them, they can run the subs up a little bit and it doesn't get mushy, and it really makes the apparent loudness so they don't have to really run the system to sound big. And all churches nowadays are trying their best to, you know, to bring youth in, and in particular, you know, the youth like bass, and still trying not to kill anybody with volume. But we'll turn up the sub just a little bit and play a few cuts.
She's a rich girl, she don't try to hide it. Diamonds on the sole of her shoes. He's a poor boy, empty as a pocket, empty as a pocket. Nothing to sing, ta-na-na, ta-na-na. She got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Ta-na-na, ta-na-na. She got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. 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 Diamonds on the soles of her shoes.